We are ready to start. I know that the time of that the speakers, the distinguished speakers, and Dean Muhtar is very valuable. So I'm going to be very short. This is a workshop organized by the Masri Institute and the Energy Studies Program. We wanted to highlight some issues related to energy transition and to also signify the interdisciplinary nature of the type of problems that need to be handled with this transition. And we want to benefit from other countries' experiences, and Germany is leading role in this transition. I don't want to say a lot, because when I asked Dean Rabia Muhtar from the Faculty of Agriculture and Food Science to give the welcoming remarks because of the relevance of the work to his work and his vision, he said, I don't want to give welcoming remarks. I would like to give a presentation just to give you an idea where we are in the region on this topic. And then we can hear Professor Christina von Haren on that same topic for the German experience. I will give Dr. Rabia the floor to give the welcoming remark and the presentation. And if you have questions to Dr. Muhtar, you may want to ask them directly after his presentation, because he has to leave for another engagement. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Rabia Muhtar for this.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Dr. Gabdar. Thank you, Christina. We had the pleasure to meet this morning, and a lot of synergy with what we're doing here at AUB. And thank you, Dr. Gabdar, for giving this opportunity. And I'm delighted to be here and share with you some of the maybe current and former work in this area. I started my career as a hydrologist, so I'm coming to the water energy food nexus from a hydrology background, from soil and water, from food, but more recently through the eyes of the Sustainable Development Goals. I think the role of renewable energy in our region lies not only in the energy sector, but how it can interface and interact with other sectors. So I would make that, so the angle is more in the sustainable development and community development. So what are the, so I will very briefly go through some thoughts that may be useful. We'll start with prerequisite for adopting an alternative energy with existing energy portfolio. So how does a new portfolio of renewable energy, what are the prerequisites? And let me start with one basic fundamental issue. Renewable energy in the West, in fact, last week I was reading a report from the US, without talking politics, the current administration, my administration in the US, has not been so keen on renewable energy. The response of the sector says we don't need any subsidy. So they are standing on their own, with Texas leading the nation in solar, not specifically, they're doing a lot of wind, but the solar energy reached a point where it is competing with fossil fuel. In fact, the fossil fuel down the road will have subsidy from the state, specifically the shale gas. Now, I'm saying this as a prerequisite. Until we reach a stage where we are manufacturing it locally, it's not going to become cheap enough for it to replace any other technology. So what are the prerequisites? We need to understand how this new portfolio interfaces with different energy users and other users. I'll give you an example. We were analyzing the water, energy, food SDG status in Morocco. The Moroccan government put forward a 43% by 2030, they want to have 43% of their energy coming in from renewable. And they're building massive infrastructure for solar energy. They have Mazen and they have a lot of capacity. However, what they have ignored is that they ignored at the same time there is a water and desalination and treated wastewater plant. There is another Green Morocco plan. So before we move forward with any renewable plan, we need to look at what is the competition for land, competition for capital, moving that plan. So that's the first prerequisite, recognizing the impact of that new portfolio in the current water, land, and agriculture. The technologies that are developed, I mean, the three top market are the US market, the Spanish, and the German. Those technologies do not work for our region. Our region has high temperature, and many of the water-intensive renewable energy doesn't work. So before we move forward, we need to look at what is the impact on the competition for land. I mean, there is a competition for land, and I'll show later some with numbers. Evaluate the role of the expanding portfolio of distributed, and this is a key, distributed energy portfolio for rural areas. My passion is how can we improve rural development, and this is an opportunity. I mean, we have to look at it. This is an opportunity for promoting energy for rural areas. So how does it work in integrating it with the existing plan? Last but not least, we need to have a readiness plan. I'll talk a little bit about the readiness plan. We developed a readiness plan a few years ago. We implemented for the GCC. I really would hope that there will be a regional effort to develop a readiness plan. I'll talk a little bit about the readiness plan later, but I'll start with some of a framework. The first would be to working through the barriers. Far and foremost, unlike many other technologies, this renewable energy technology is embedded in our local conditions. There has to be a local R&D. Unless we have a local R&D, unless we have a local capacity for that, developing the local know-how, we have very unique conditions, so the technology brought up from outside is not going to work. Culture of innovation. Many of us, I know that for a fact, you register your IP, you go outside to register it, because we don't have protection for IP. That needs to happen. That needs to be, our innovation has to be protected. It has to be rewarded. Last but not least, manufacturing. We have to, along that same promoting the renewable, we have to be manufacturing. Moving to the second, enabling policies. There has to be policies that allow industry to move forward. Pricing, all studies have indicated that pricing is really an issue for promoting renewable. Public awareness, incentives for integrating and producing and adopting that technology is not there and need to be looked at. Now, there are more expertise in the room on emerging technologies. I'm not going to say much there, except that there is room for all of the above. There was a lot of debate. We go PV, we go thermal, a lot of debate, and there's a lot of hybrid system. This is not an area I can add much value, but there is room for all of the above in this area. The one thing that I believe we have an opportunity, we differ in the politics, we don't agree on politics, but let's see if we can agree on regional integration when it comes to water, energy, food, health initiatives. And I think this is something AUB can make an impact there, and there's a lot of opportunity for us to really make that statement. Last but not least, a readiness plan that we have worked on a framework. I will not have much time to talk about it, but the framework include I call them the three I's. The framework is based on institutional mapping, the infrastructural mapping, and last but not least, individuals mapping, the capacity building for human capacity. So there is a framework that we've developed. We'll be happy to discuss this offline later, but there is a report that was published by Irina. I think at least if we can agree on a general framework for mapping the regional, the region, where are the strengths and weaknesses that we need to apply. I borrowed this slide, adopted it from DESERTEC 2011. Some of you are familiar with DESERTEC. I think it's a concept that needs to be maybe looked at, if not with DESERTEC, but through other means. I think that we don't have a good grasp on mapping the solar, the wind, the hydro, the biomass, and geotechnical. This is something that I believe we could develop partnership with the leading in this area. The German have done a lot of work there. Very quickly, there is a lot of interface between water and energy, and I think it would be important as we move into our portfolio to identify where the penetration of renewable energy can impact the water and wastewater. And there's some examples for desalination in this case. This is in fact, I developed this slide on the way to meet with DLR a couple of years ago, and in the back of the envelope, people were asking how much land we need, how much land we need. So those are the three dots needed for Germany, for the EU and for the world. This is in North Africa. The intensity, the radiance incident rays in the North Africa region is very, very conducive to renewable energy. Of course, this is now probably that has changed because technology has changed and a lot of our capacity has improved. So, but this just gives some idea. I will not go through this, except I will go back, and you could read it. I will go back to highlighting the role of R&D and the role of local knowledge in terms of how does the new technology portfolio interfaces with the current infrastructure. And remember the three I's as an initial discussion for developing a readiness plan that we desperately need in this region. So thank you so much. I hope this was useful. Yeah. Please.
You're talking about manufacturing in the region. Do you think we can compete with the Chinese manufacturing with their economy of scale and to manufacture actually PV cells in this region?
It's a good point, but what I really meant there, so the answer is yes, because there's no technology that matches our temperature, our dust, our conditions that we have. So the technology that I'm talking about has to be developed for this region. Yes, you can hire the Chinese to do it for you, to have the R&D centers that will customize that for us. Maybe financially it will be cheaper. But remember, the exercise that the Americans are realizing it now, after so many years of exporting labor outside to Mexico in this case, they are now realizing that it wasn't about the economy. It wasn't about the cost. It was about building national capacity. So maybe on the short term, it's cheaper to buy that technology from China. But long term, I think we need to build that capacity locally, in my opinion. And I mean, how many capacity exists in this room in young generation that they're looking for a job, very qualified? And I think building it locally would allow for a much more unforeseen capacity for employment and for developing this region. So it's not only about the money. It's not only about getting it cheaper. It's about the entire supply chain and the impact on building resilience and know-how. Absolutely. In fact, the plan that I just mentioned was published first with IRENA. I worked with IRENA to publish that, and my recommendation was this is a plan. We had only 3-4 countries in the GCC that we mapped, and my recommendation was to do it regionally. So I'm very glad to see it being implemented, but we need to be part of it. Lebanon needs to be part of it. Now, the plan is not perfect, so maybe some elements could be modified for the Lebanese condition, but at least we need a similar data that when we go and map our resources, our three eyes or whatever, maybe there will be a fourth eye, with their condition, at least we can talk, compare apple to apple. But I'm delighted to hear this. Thank you.